Father's house, in my Father's house, peace and happiness there, in my Father's house, there is joy, joy, joy. Saints of God will be there, in my Father's house.
Help us out.
In my Father's house, in my Father's house, saints of God will be there, in my Father's house, there is joy, joy, joy.
Don't you want to go?
Don't you want to go with me? To my father's house. Don't you want to go with me to my Father's house? There is joy, joy, joy.
Come and go with me to my father's house.
Come and go with me to my Father's house. There is joy, joy, joy.
Amen. And you came, yay.
Song is called I Stand Amazed. That's not the right key. Ruined it, Candy. Ruined it.
Oh, no.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and I wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned unclean. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. He took my sins and my sorrow. He made them his very own.
He bore my burden.
He bore my burden to Calvary. Suffered and died alone. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me.
Now let's listen to the words of this last verse, all right?
When with the ransomed in glory, his face I at last shall see, it will be my joy through the ages to sing of his love for me. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love
How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me.
Thank you for singing with us, church. You may be seated.
Good morning, church. Well, it's so good to see everyone here this beautiful day, and happy early Valentine's Day for each one today. I know that's going on all over the country. Amen. And the scripture I have this morning is Romans 5:8, but God commanded his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us.
Amen.
I praise the Lord for that. And so good to see everyone this morning, and lots going on, different ones that are sick with the flu and viruses and all those kind of things, so I ask you to lift those in prayer, and those that's traveling. We also want to lift up the Moore family, Charles Chuck Moore passed, it's Nicole's father, it passed, and they're having his services Tuesday on the 14th at 3 o'clock, a celebration of life at Witten's Mount Ellison, so I ask you to lift that family in prayer, please. And like I said, so glad to see everyone here. Look at your neighbor. Tell them you're glad to hear because you may have not been able to speak yet. Amen. Amen. Now, thankful to the ones that set up the coffee and the cookies and stuff in the back. Thank you. Let's go. Good to see everyone. This time I'm going to ask Debbie Gilbert. She's got something the Lord has laid on her heart to share with each of us this morning. So put your hands together for her this morning. Amen. Got a shout out. Got a lot of people's birthdays and anniversaries to Alex and Richardson's birthday on the 14th. Kenny and Lisa Witt anniversary on the 14th. Suzanne Bethay's birthday's on the 15th. And our sheriff, E.W. Vyre's birthday's on the 16th. That's just the ones I know. But God bless each of y'all to celebrate. Go ahead, sweetheart.
Good morning, everybody. Also, good morning to everybody watching and listening. I had to write down what I need to say because everyone knows I have such a problem talking. So, but I'd like to talk to everyone about a fellow brother in Christ of ours. He's a pastor who is trying to reach lost souls in a part of the world where God's word is not readily available. His name is Pastor David, and he lives in Kenya. He ministers and pastors 7 churches, and he witnesses to as many people as he can get to. He has dreams and aspirations of using the land that was donated to him to build a church for God's children to be able to go to and have a place that's safe to worship, and to build a hospital where health care is almost non-existent, and when it is available, it's extremely expensive. When he wants to build a school where education is not a luxury for the ones that can afford it, but it's actually a priority for all of their children to be able to get education. Everything that he inspires to do is for the honor and glory of God. He takes care of himself, his wife, his children, his mother, and recently his sister just passed and went to heaven, and now he's raising his sister's children also. His love for God and his undying allegiance to spread God's word, excuse me, and to save lost souls knows no boundaries, except for financial, as I'm sure a lot of us are aware of. For over a year now, Pastor David's plight for a monthly donation has weighed very heavily on my heart. God has talked to me, and I've talked to him late into many, many nights. And I know Pam has tried to work on it. We've all tried to work on it, but it seems the devil has just stopped us at every turn. But here in the United States, we have resources readily available to us to learn God's word and his will for us at our fingertips. It's just a push of a button, and we can read God's word. This is not so for Pastor David and all of his colleagues who stay on their knees crying out to God to help them spread God's word and to help the people in their country. Faith is believing that God will answer your prayers. And that is the foundation that they live by. So I'm submitting a loving, godly challenge to my brothers and sisters in Christ. And if it touches anyone's heart through the Holy Spirit to help, I beg of you to please do so. $200 goes a long way per month to help Pastor David in all the endeavors that he undertakes to do God's work. I myself pledge a love offering of $25 per month. And I'm reaching out to you and to everyone listening and to everyone watching. And I'm reaching out to at least seven others that could maybe match my $25. But if you can't do that, if you have a $10 love offering to make as a donation, any gift would be a blessing to Pastor David and to his people. The scripture in Proverbs 27:17 says, if you help the poor, you are lending to the Lord, and he will repay you. When we give to God's work, we are investing in his kingdom, and he will repay us, not only here on earth, but also in heaven. And just so everyone knows, Pastor David is a reputable pastor. We are affiliated with him through our brother in Christ, Nick Marika. I always mispronounce his name. And he has been to Kenya on a couple missionary trips to visit and witness the godliness of Pastor David's ministry. And the pertinent information that y'all need to know if anyone decides to do this, you go to www.crosscountryfm.com, click on donate, and in the memo box, write Pastor David Kenya. And as I said, I'm reaching out to seven others that can match the $25. But again, if a $5 offering or a $10 offering is all that you can do, like I said, anything would be greatly appreciated by them. And the website that we're using is also the website for Solid Rock Baptist Church. So God bless each of you, and I'd like to close in a word of prayer, please. Dear Lord, Father, Lord, I'll keep this simple. Without your grace and your mercy and your love, Lord, we have nothing. And Lord, I just ask, Lord, that you reach into everyone's heart and soul, Lord, and make them feel the need in this country, Lord, for the people that so desperately need to hear your word, Lord. Lord, and just let everyone know, Lord, that this comes from my love for you and my wish to spread your word as I wish your word to be spread all across the world. In your most precious heavenly name, I pray. Amen. Amen.
Sister Debbie, so if you, Lord, laid on your heart to help, please do. Back in your bulletin, it's crosscountryfm.com, and just click on donate and put in Pastor Dave from Kenya on the memo. We'll know where it goes, and he'll get it. We just praise God for him and all that he does there. Spreading God's word. We can just be a part of that. Amen? Amen. Thank you, Sister Debbie. This time, I ask Brother Mike Duff to come up and do our scripture reading this time. I appreciate that. Amen.
Good morning, church. With this last election, I think the Lord has given us a few precious moments here to get things straight, get our country in line. And going along with what Debbie says, I think anything that God has his hand on, we should try to touch. Yeah. Anything that we can do to help. I know in here, as you see me, we're not overrun by money. There's no doubt about that. But like Debbie's saying, a little bit from a lot of people comes up with a lot of money. So let's all keep that in mind and know that people out there are definitely suffering in this world. You know, we're over here and we're blessed to be in this nation because as of this moment, we're not being persecuted like the people in the Middle East. But the Christians in the Middle East are being definitely persecuted today, big time. So I'm hoping and praying, and I'm seeing it starting to happen, that this administration is going to lean towards the Christian people, trying to get them out of that area over there. It needs to happen. I'm going to be reading today from Jeremiah 33, 1-11. I want to say one more thing before I start. For John Caitlin, the first time I met you, brother, you come in this church. The Lord spoke to me that day and told me he was going to touch you. And I know that sounds crazy, And it even sounds crazy because I'm saying it, coming from me. But I'm telling you, John, the Lord has his hand on you. There's no doubt about that. He's going to touch you and he's going to heal you, brother. I'm telling you. Praise God. I'm reading from the book, Jeremiah 33. I'm going 1 through 11 this morning. Just follow along. These are the promises of peace and prosperity. While Jeremiah was still confined in the courtyard of God, the Lord gave him the second message. The Lord, maker of heaven and earth, the Lord is his name. Say this, ask me and I will tell you some remarkable secrets about what is going to happen here. For this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. Though you have torn down the houses of this city and even the king's palace to get materials to strengthen the walls against the siege of weapons of the enemy, the Babylonians will still enter. The men of this city are already as good as dead, for I have determined to destroy them in my terrible anger. I have abandoned them because of all their wickedness. Nevertheless, the time will come when I will heal Jerusalem's damage and give her prosperity and peace. I will restore the fortunes of Judah and Israel and rebuild their cities. I will cleanse away their sins against me, and I will forgive all their sins of rebellion. Then this city will bring me joy, glory, and honor before all the nations of the earth. The people of the world will see the good I do for my people, and will tremble with awe. This is what the Lord says. You say, this land has been ravaged, and the people and animals have all disappeared. Yet in the empty streets of Jerusalem and Judah's other towns, there will be heard once more the sounds of joy and laughter. The joyful voices of bridegrooms and brides will be heard again, along with the joyous songs of people bringing thanksgiving offerings to the Lord. They will sing, give thanks to the Lord Almighty, for the Lord is good. His faithful love endures forever. May God bless the reading of his word. You may be seated.
Thank you, Brother Mike. Amen. I'll ask deacons come forward, please. It's time for our morning tithes and offerings. And shall keep Brother Ron Hamner in your prayers as well. Amen.
Y'all know this one, so you have to sing it with me, okay?
It's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. It's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Not my brother, not my sister, but it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Not my brother, sister, but it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. It's me, it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. It's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer.
Given that this week is the week on whatever day works best for your work schedule, that you and your significant other will most likely be celebrating Valentine's Day, I thought it might be fitting to share a song that is about the greatest kind of love that any of us can ever know. Whether you do have a significant other or not, this love is available to you every day, all day long, no matter what situation you're in. And most of you know this song, so please sing it with us. The song is called Amazing Love.
I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted, you were condemned. I'm alive and well, your spirit is within me because you died and rose again.
Sing that one more time.
I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted, you were condemned. I'm alive and well, your spirit is within me because you died and rose again.
Sing Amazing Love.
Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true, that it's my joy to honor you in all I do, to honor you.
I'm forgiven.
I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted, you were condemned. I'm alive and well, your spirit is within me because you died and rose again.
Sing Amazing Love.
Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true, that it's my joy to honor you in all I do, to honor you. Joy to honor you in all I do, to honor you.
Amen.
Wonderful.
I got love. If you can get
if
Anna up here,
if she's able. Can we call Anna? The part of one accord that's. Oh, okay. This is babies.
I understand.
It's all right.
That takes priority.
Children's church is dismissed. We thank the Lord for our little ones. Let's do this one while they're going out.
Oh. Amen. Oh, that's just beyond sweet.
The master. We're not going to miss out on this.
Oh, okay.
Right. The master of improvise.
Okay. We can do the other one. Yep. That was good to me.
Oh, I need this one.
Yeah. Yeah. He won't let you take him, will he? She's going to sing from afar. Amen.
We're an accommodating church, aren't we?
Yes, we are.
This ain't the first time we've done that. I remember one Sunday I was performing the song, The Angels Rejoiced, and my grandmother and my aunt were in the back, and I finally talked them into singing along with us on a Sunday morning. Mm-hmm. But they wouldn't come up to the front, so we had to take microphones back to them.
And we did.
But we made it work. We made it work.
That's good. Okay. I'm going to catch my breath on this one.
All right. And breathe in.
Breathe deeply.
Breathe in with
help
the
us out with this. And thank and the Lord for that. Out. Amen. I got a love down deep in my heart. I got a love down deep in my heart. I got a peace that passes all understanding. I got a new love that's never ending. This love I've got, it's so, so true, it's got a hold on me, and it won't turn loose. I got a love down deep in my heart. I got a love down deep in my heart. And I was walking down a lonely road, upon my shoulder lay a heavy load like a million. I didn't understand, I had a Savior waiting to take my hand. And one evening, as the sun set low, I heard a story, how he loved me so. Now I'm happy because he came and set me apart. I got his love down deep in my heart. I got a love down deep in my heart. I got a love down deep in my heart. I got a peace that passes all understanding. I got a new love that's never ending. This love I've got is so, so true. It's got a hold on me, and it won't turn loose. I got a love down deep in my heart. I got a love down deep in my heart.
I want to tell you, since Jesus saved my soul, that old devil trying to gain control. So every morning, before I start my day, I read the Bible, take some time to pray. Jesus tells me he's my Savior and friend. He'll love me till the very end. So I want to keep it in pain, keep it down in my heart. I got a love down deep in my heart. Yeah.
I got a love down deep in my heart. I got a love down deep in my heart. I got a peace that passes all understanding. I got a new love that's never ending. This love I've got is so, so true. It's got a hold on me, and it won't turn loose. I got a love down deep in my heart. I got a love down deep in my heart. I got a love down deep in my heart. I got a love down deep in my heart. I got a peace that passes all understanding. I got a new love that's never ending. This love I've got is so, so true. It's got a hold on me, and it won't turn loose. I got a love down deep in my heart. I got a love down deep in my heart. I got a love down deep in my heart. I got a love down deep in my heart.
Amen. I got too many cakes. I've had too much Valentine cake all week.
There you go. Thank you.
I praise the Lord. Thank y'all. Amen.
All right, now it's some preaching time. Amen. Amen. God is good. Come on up, sweetie.
We're going to be looking this morning in Mark chapter 9. Mark chapter 9. There's a boom every time I talk up here where the floor vibrates. I'm not really sure whether that's the Wizard of Oz effect or what it is that's going on up here.
Pay no attention to the man behind the curtain.
Exactly. Well, I want you to know that in case you haven't felt it, there's a huge struggle going on in this room. Right here this morning, there was a really incredibly intense prayer meeting Friday night. And whenever you do something like that and the Holy Spirit gets active, the devil gets mad. And it's been one attack after another since Friday night. But I want you to understand, he's going to still lose. What I'm going to ask everybody this morning is to just put everything out of your mind that might be troubling you for the moment and focus on the Word of God. And then you'll understand what I'm talking about. In Mark chapter 9,
It said, and when Jesus came to his disciples, we're reading verse 14, he saw a great multitude about them and the scribes questioning with them. All of the disciples had gotten cornered by the scribes. These were people who copied the Bible, who wrote the Bible. They interpreted it. They taught it. Doctors of the law. And they were standing around the disciples talking to them. And straightway all the people, when they saw Jesus, were greatly amazed and running to him, saluted him. And he asked the scribes, "What question ye with them? What are you asking them?" And one of the multitude answered and said, "Master, I brought unto you my son, which has a dumb spirit. He's not able to talk, and he has all these problems." It says, "And wheresoever he taketh him, he teareth him." He's talking about this spirit that is inside his son. And it said, "He foams and he gnashes with his teeth and he pines away. And I spoke to your disciples that they should cast him out, and they could not." Most unusual situation here. And maybe this morning you are questioning your own ability and your own prayers as to whether or not they are getting through over the situation that you're in. And Jesus answered, "O faithless generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I put up with you? Bring him unto me." And they brought him unto Jesus, and when he saw him, straightway the spirit tear him, and he fell on the ground, and he wallowed foaming. Here was an actual, this was not a sickness, this was an evil spirit that had taken over this boy, and it was causing him to do all of these things. And he asked his father, Jesus asked his father, "How long is it ago that this came to him?" And he said, "Of a child. And oft times it cast him into the fire and into the waters to destroy him. But if you can do anything, have compassion on us and help us." You ever ask God, "God, if you can do anything, would you do it?" Maybe not out loud, but you know you thought it. And Jesus said to him, and I want you to hear this, "If you can believe, all things are possible to him that believeth." And this is the key verse right here this morning that I want you to understand. And this is what the message is about. Straightway the father of the child cried out and said with tears, "Lord, I believe. Help thou my unbelief." In other words, I believe you, but I've got some unbelief here and I need you to help me. And when Jesus saw the people running together, he rebuked the foul spirit, saying unto him, "Thou dumb and deaf spirit, I charge thee, come out of him and enter no more into him." And the spirit cried and rent him sore and came out of him. And he was as one dead, insomuch they said, "He is dead." But Jesus took him by the hand and lifted him up, and he arose. And when he was coming to the house, his disciples asked privately, "Why couldn't we cast him out?" And he said unto them, "This kind can come forth by nothing but by prayer and fasting." Here was an unusual situation. One that was such a serious situation that the disciples could not even do anything about it because their walk was not where it needed to be with Christ, even though they had the power in many cases to lay hands on someone and heal them and to do all these miraculous things, yet there was still something lacking in their lives that they did not have the power that they needed. I entitled this from a phrase I saw in a TV show one time that is so true. As you believe, so shall you do. I want you to think about that. You will do what you believe in. You will act accordingly to what your beliefs are. The level of one person's belief often determines the outcome of a crisis. Anybody here ever have a crisis? If you are not in crisis now, you can go on home. Go ahead. You don't need to listen to this. This is for people that are in crisis. But I will warn you, if you leave, you'll be in a crisis in a day or two anyway. So you might as well stick around and listen anyway. We have got to come to a level of belief to the point that for us there is no safety net. There's no plan B. And it takes a very close, consistent, and I will add a sacrificial walk with Christ in order to get that. Think about this. What are you doing for the Lord? What are you doing for the sake of the gospel? What have you sacrificed in your life for Him? And I want you to think about that, because that's an important part, is living a sacrificial life in order to walk closely with the Lord. One time there was King David wanted to make a great sacrifice, and someone gave him the stuff that he needed to do the sacrifice, and he said, "I will never give to God something that cost me nothing." That's pretty heavy. I want you to think about that. As you believe, you're going to behave. So shall you do. The level of one's belief will also determine the level of one's commitment to Christ. Your belief will dictate your behavior. Your belief will dictate your habits. And it will even dictate your desires, your level of commitment and your belief. For instance, think about these things. I'm going to give you a few things that's going to challenge you. How strongly do you believe in the existence of heaven? I could ask any Christian on the street. I could ask any Christian in this building right here. And every one of them will go, "Oh, yeah, I believe in heaven." Well, if that is so, then why do all of the things of this earth matter like it's life and death to you? It's going to get real quiet, so just get ready for this. Does anybody have any idea what is waiting for us up in heaven? L. Ron Hubbard, the founder of the Church of Scientology, where it costs between $38,000 to $40,000 to be a full-fledged member of the church, said that he went to heaven once back in the 60s, and it looked like Disneyland, only a little bit more run down. He is a nut, by the way. Well, he was a nut. He's a believer now, okay? You know, but seriously, there were only two people that we know of in the Bible that saw heaven. Paul was told to shut up and not say a word about it because it was too amazing, and especially with the ability that Paul had to write. And John, the apostle, saw it, and it was beyond what he could put into words how beautiful it was. Think of it, folks. The family that has gone on before you that knew Christ is there waiting for you. You will become immortal. You will never be sick again. You'll be in the presence of God. There is beauty up there beyond what any of the apostles could describe. But we struggle so hard to stay here. We rarely put any effort in preparing to go to our permanent home. I ask you, do you really, really believe that heaven is there and that it's waiting for you if you love the Lord? Nearly 2 years ago, February 26, my mother died. There were no two people any closer than me and my mother. We would sit down and talk for the longest time. We'd get on the telephone, and we'd love to argue different subjects. And, you know, being a woman, Mama always won. And she was a very godly woman. We were very, very close. And there are many times that I wanted to just pick the phone up and call her and tell her something really cool that happened, and I can't do it. And I even preached her funeral myself. And I'm going to tell you what held me together and still does. Because I've got a lot of people that I love that are up there. It's the fact that I know beyond a shadow of a doubt that heaven exists. The Bible says that it's their blessed hope. You don't have any blessed hope down here, buddy, let me tell you. This old body deteriorates and gets worse by the day. Well, maybe some of y'all don't think so, but wait, just wait. It's coming. I love to look at all them pretty boy rock stars from the 70s. They're all old, fat, and bald now. That's Peter Frampton. Oh, my Lord. Have y'all seen him? He has to put a bandana on his head because he ain't got no hair left up there no more. And he had them pretty golden locks. And well, anyway, there is justice in this world. Any of y'all don't know who Peter Frampton is, ask your parents when you get home. But it's a blessed hope, people. We've got something waiting on us there. You need to really believe in the existence of it. And once you do, it'll change your life and you'll want to tell other people about it. My question number two here is, just how strongly do you believe in God's healing power? Now, I will tell you up front, I'm not a prosperity preacher. It is not always God's will to heal, because if that's true, nobody would ever go home to be with him. That's fact. We all age and we all die of something, but there is many times that God has a will to heal you and you just don't want it. You don't think to ask him. You don't pursue it. We fall apart when we get bad news from the doctor. That's why I don't go anymore. Amen, Mike. Amen, Pam. Everybody I know that's been to the doctor found something horrible wrong with them. Now, that's where ignorance is bliss, buddy. But you know, when we hear bad news about a health crisis, it's natural to feel bad. It's natural to nearly panic. But we are called to be supernatural, people. What we need to do when these things get upon us and happen, we need to get on our knees and we need to start to pray, and then we need to obey. We need to obey God. Do you believe in the power of prayer? I'm looking at several people in here that all had something awful happen to them that was not fixable by a surgeon. But they all got healed miraculously of some of the most terrible things. I've seen cancer, aneurysms, burst appendix. Candy walked around for 2 weeks with a burst appendix. And God miraculously healed her on a Sunday morning. I've seen a whole lot of these things happen. Many of you could come up and give a testimony of what prayer did for you. Well, may I say this? You want to put some rubber to the road? Every Friday night, we meet downstairs in the chapel. We had over 20 people this last Friday night. One of the most intense prayer meetings I'd ever been in. And we get together and we put this board up and we put people's names on that board, and people call in, people write in, people show up, and we pray for them. And if you need prayer, we anoint you with oil and we circle around you and we lay hands on you and we pray. Or you can come and help us pray for somebody else or pray for a situation. And let me just say this. I challenge everybody in this building, give it at least one Friday night a month. Just come one Friday night and I guarantee you, you will never be the same when you leave. If you really believe in the power of prayer, come and help us pray on Friday nights. I ask you this. How strongly do you believe that Jesus is the only way to heaven? Churches nowadays, they like diversity and tolerance. Do I look like somebody that likes diversity and tolerance? I'm sorry. There ain't but one way. Bible says it ain't but one way. Jesus said out of his own mouth, there ain't but one way. Now, either he's right or he's lying. Which is it? We've got to come to the point to whether we believe what Jesus said or we think he's lying. Bottom line, there is no other way. I don't care what any pastor tells you. I don't care what any talk show host tells you. Jesus told his people I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh to the Father but by me. You want to make it to heaven? You want eternal life? You want salvation? Then you got to do what everybody else did. You got to go through Jesus. And if you believe that, if you really do believe that, then why are you not busy sharing others with him? If you are sold on a particular product, you will tell everybody in the world about it. If you like a particular food, you tell everybody in the world about it. Man, that's the best stuff I ever ate. You go to a hotel, to a restaurant, to a ball game, and you brag and brag and brag on that. So I ask you again, do you truly believe that no one comes to the Father but by Jesus? Do you believe he is who he says he is? Then you should be warning those who are caught up in these false religions and cults and say, well, that's their right to do what they, to believe what they believe. And well, you know what? It's their right to go to hell too, but are you going to stand by and let them do it? Are you not going to warn somebody if you care about them? Well, I don't want to offend them, Dave. Far better thing to offend them here and let them get right with God than to let them slide right on into hell where they'll be offended forever and ever and ever. Do you really believe it? My next question is, how strongly do you believe in the transforming power of salvation? No matter what kind of problems you have, what kind of a sin problem you have, what is going on in your life, addictions, I don't care, whatever it may be. The only hope for all of these things, the only hope for a broken home, the only hope for any kind of sin is the blood of Jesus Christ. He can take a person of the vilest sort and change them into a child of God. Like that group Cornerstone was saying, he can turn whiskey into diapers. I like that. He can turn cocaine into washers and dryers. He can take things and transform it into things that could not possibly be. I fellowship with some of the wildest people that ever walked the face of this earth that are now saved, and people still just can't believe how that's possible. I love that. I love that. I believe in the transforming power of salvation. What about the Bible? Was it just a book written several thousand years ago by 40 some men over a period of 1600 years just to scare their children into behaving? I can think of a whole lot better ways to scare my children into behaving than this right here. Because some of the stuff in here is permanent. It was written, it took 1600 years to write this. And many of those people who wrote it never saw each other, never knew that the other one ever existed. Never read anything they wrote, but they wrote the exact same thing. Page after page after page. I devoted my life and a promise to God back in June of 1969 that I would read it every day. I had no idea that I would go to school for it as well. But I devoted my life to studying the Bible every single day. And I can tell you, the older I get, the more I can tell you with assurance that every word in that book is true. It's powerful. And not only that, it's settled. The Bible says, thy word, O God, is forever settled in heaven. It's settled in hell too today. Oh, it might not be settled in some of these colleges and universities and all of these great places of higher learning where once you go in, you come out a complete stone fool. But it's going to be settled in there one of these days. Might not be settled now, but it will be. And finally, what I'm going to ask you this morning, and this is one I want everybody to really search their soul over, because this means more than anything else I've said to y'all. is just how strongly do you believe that hell is a real place where people, real people, go without Christ? It's real, people. Hell is just as real as Lynchburg and Amherst and Charlottesville. And it's a place where real people spend a real eternity according to the Word of God in both the Old Testament and the New Testament. The reason, you want to know why we do what we do here? You know, you want to know why this church struggles to make it, and we have fought against everything in the world to shut us down and to run us off, but we keep coming back. And I'll tell you why we exist. The main reason we exist, it's show, Lord, ain't to make money. If that's true, we failed really bad. It isn't to offer programs, though we may have them. It is certainly not to entertain you. Some churches over in town, I heard an advertisement, we will entertain you if you come to our church. We're not going to entertain you. We worship the Lord. If you enjoy it, praise God, but it's not there to entertain you. This church is not here to give you a place to socialize. The number one reason that Solid Rock Church exists is that we believe that there is a place called hell. And we believe that when people die without Christ, they go to hell. The Bible says that. And it said it's a place of torments with an S on the end of it. There's more than one torment that goes in there because they rejected Christ. They didn't want nothing to do with him. They didn't want his redeeming power. They didn't want to follow him. And he did everything he could to get them saved, and they wouldn't have it. And so there they are. One of the worst things about hell, in Luke chapter 16, it says, remember. Remember. And it's not like you won't know anything in there. You remember every opportunity that somebody said to you, would you come to Christ? Would you accept him today? Would you get saved? And you kept saying no over and over and over again. And they have that memory forever and ever. The Bible talks about flames and about heat. And it says where the worm dieth not. That's an old expression. And the flames are not quenched. It's a real place. If I did not believe it exists, I would not waste my time right here this morning. I'd be on the lake like where everybody else is at this morning. I'd be doing something else. But I believe it's real. I believe it exists. And I don't want nobody to go there. And I don't want nobody's blood on my hands. And that's why I'm telling you about it. It's not pleasant. It's not something that you probably hear on TV. But it's real and it's there. And you need to shun it. If you really, really, really believe that it exists, it will change your life. I had somebody say one time, if we could take the cap off of it and just look for about 5 seconds, we would never be the same again. So just try to envision that in your mind. We need to start really believing what we claim we believe, if we ever want to amount to anything as a Christian. This isn't a Sunday morning thing, and then when the hour's up, you're done and your life goes on. Either it changes your life, it transforms you into something different, or you didn't get it. It ain't real. And so this morning, our prayer really needs to be like this man that came to Jesus. Lord, I believe. Help my unbelief. Ask God to give you a real belief in the existence of all these things that I told you about. I really, really, really believe with all my heart from studying prophecy, and I've been reading it for years and studying it and studying it, that we got just a short window, folks. We got a short window that we can go out and evangelize without being arrested for it. We've got an opportunity to share our beliefs with people now without being punished for it. There's that little window of grace that God has given us. And having said that, I ask that everybody would jump through that window as fast as you can. This morning, we're going to give an invitation. And I would ask if Christians, would you bow your head and start praying? Because the devil is really, really hopping mad at this one, and he's going to distract He's going to tell you no. He's going to tell you wait. He's going to tell you don't do this. Don't embarrass yourself. What is wrong with you? Folks, listen to me. This may be your opportunity to accept Christ for real. Coming to church, don't do it. Even working around church or doing stuff for the, that's not it. It's, are you really saved? Did you ever ask Jesus to forgive you of your sins and save you? Have you ever done that before? We want to give you that opportunity to be the real deal today. Maybe you are saved, but man, you've been kind of sitting the bench and you haven't really done what he's told you to do, and your worship has been sporadic. Everything has been sporadic in your life, and he's just there when it's convenient. And now you say, Lord, I really do believe these things I heard this morning, and I want to walk with you closer than I ever have because the time is short. Folks, that's for you. Maybe you have a need for prayer. Maybe you need to pray for somebody else. It don't really matter. We're going to invite anyone and everyone that needs to come. We're going to have some prayer warriors meet down front here. Take them by the hand. Tell them, please pray for me. They'll be glad to do it this morning. I would ask if everyone would stand very reverently.